Today's episode of the Aesthetic Fellows podcast is brought to you by New Year, New Me, or at least that's a thing that people say since it is 2019 after all. Welcome to what should be one hell of a year, at least for myself and hopefully for each of you, and probably my guest as well here in Kyle Bodie, longtime friend and the, let's see, is it owner and founder, president? It's not CEO, I can promise you that, of Driveline Baseball. He'll get into that and a whole bunch more. As him and I, we spent some time at the back end of 2018 just chatting about life and what 2018 was, entrepreneurship, and how we handle the struggles of kind of what we're both trying to accomplish, which frankly is a lot. I know the last time that I did this with Kyle at the early stages of 2018, a lot of people enjoyed it. Kyle, a very dynamic guy, very smart guy, very successful one too, but much like myself, as I like to say, started from the bottom and now we're here. So it's been a fun ride for both of us. We love to get together and talk about it, but we also know that, hey, we've still got a lot more that we want to accomplish, and we also go over that as well. This is a two-parter. The first one is just us kind of chit-chatting, and then the second part, which will come out a little bit later, is the Q&A portion, where we took questions from people from Twitter and Instagram and various other places, and we answered them to the best of our ability before getting some dinner at Ruth's Chris. So do enjoy part one here with Kyle and I, and before you do that, of course, you got to listen to Jule Vera, J-U-L-E-V-E-R-A, so they'll play us in, and then me and Kyle B will be talking aplenty. All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of the Cedric Phillips podcast. I am your host, Cedric Phillips, at Cedric A. Phillips on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And I am joined once again for the second time this year by longtime friend, and I can never remember if it's CEO or president.
So, president.
Oh, geez, that was firm.
President.
Okay.
Not the CEO.
I don't know the difference.
We can get into that.
Oh, that's great. That's a good first question.
It's a great cold open right there.
President of Driveline Baseball and all-around piece of shit. We're leaving that in.
Okay.
That's Kyle Bodie, everybody. Hi, yeah. Buddy.
Hello. I'm also the founder. That's the most important.
Ooh, okay. See, now we're using big words.
That's the most important part.
Founder and president, but not CEO.
I'm not the CEO.
Okay.
No. I like to think about it. Driveline is probably, it's got 35 employees.
Okay.
Probably worth eight figures, you know, like 10 to 15 million.
Okay.
So I think, not a humble brag, but it's a thought, am I qualified to be the CEO of any company worth $15 million? No. So why would I be the CEO of my own company? And that is actually a real thing that is a big problem. Like people grow into roles that they are not qualified for.
Yeah, sure.
It's the Peter principle in a lot of ways, but really bad in startups where just because you're the founder doesn't mean you are qualified to have any of the roles. You know, so I am not qualified to be CEO. I am qualified to be the president, which is like guiding, how we delineate it is the CEO is executive strategy for a company that's small. Generally, your CEO that's not really a title. My partner is really more of the COO, like operating officer. So he makes sure payroll, hiring, HR, you know, organizational shit stays together, the rent gets paid, you know, like very basic stuff.
The shit you don't want to do.
Yeah, it's very important stuff, but also like stuff that I'm bad at, obviously, and you are too.
Yep.
So I ceded that title to him. And the president is more like guiding corporate strategy, partnerships, networking, kind of the chief marketing officer, like that, those types of things. And that's what I'm good at. And it's what I do. And I'm also the director of R&D. So that's the difference between the two. And I was very happy to give up the CEO title. People are way too attached to that thing. Like, you're the most important person. It's like, no, I just signed ownership documents today. We made some changes that I'm still the majority shareholder. And I'm not.
That's important.
Yeah, there's no co-founder. It's just me. I'm not giving up a founder title. Not that my partner wants it, but no, it's me. So I stress that I'm the founder and the president of Driveline Baseball Enterprises, LLC. So that is what I am. Yeah.
Noted. I'm going to keep that all up here. So the next time we do one of these, I'm going to ask you again.
Yeah.
Just so that you know.
It's a stupid distinction.
Yeah. Well, it's a distinction nonetheless. So yeah. That's not bad.
Yeah.
Busy year for the both of us.
Yeah.
To say the least.
Yeah. Where do you want to get started?
Well, I'm fucking tired. That's where I want to get started.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can start there.
I'm fucking tired. It's December. What is today? Today's the 27th. It's actually my mom's birthday. Happy birthday, Mom. I called her before we did this.
Good.
Yeah, my dad reminded me or I would have forgot. 7:30 p.m. Pacific time.
I have to buy Christmas gifts for my parents. I'm not kidding. I haven't done that yet. Oh, shit. I'm going to buy him a gift certificate to Lola, I think. Is that a good restaurant in Cleveland?
It's a very good restaurant.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Michael Simon, good restaurant. Yeah, I bet.
Like, where else should I get? Like, Lola and then... A couple places. I'm gonna get $100. It's not like they drink a ton of wine, you know.
Yeah, like I think that always buying someone just like you can just buy them wine or something, right? That's always a safe gift, right?
Nah, my dad is like your dad. It's not gonna happen.
It's just not gonna
your
drink.
Dad's black and my dad's white. Other than that, they're the exact same.
Yeah. Okay. Fair. Like, just doesn't drink. Just sits around.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Yeah. He drinks a fucking Beck's every once a week.
Brown shirt. Is that in play?
Yeah. We'll figure it out. Maybe. Oh, you know, I'll do Lola and then Great Lakes Brewery.
See, there you go.
Yeah.
There you go. That'll play.
Yeah,
that'll play. Local.
Yeah.
Local. Support your local business.
Exactly. He'll drink a beer, too. That's good. Yeah.
Yeah, that's all part of weirdly being tired is just, like, you just kind of forget to do shit.
Yeah.
I've been, like, in this... It's supposed to be right now, right? It's supposed to be like the wind down of the year, right? This is where everybody,
sure.
You relax and you recharge. And,
that's probably true. Yeah, generally speaking. Yeah. My business, not so much.
No, man.
Yeah.
No, there's like no recharging to be done. It's actually kind of frightening. I was really looking forward to these, to like the way the holidays were set up because it was Saturday, Sunday, and then Monday was Christmas Eve and Tuesday's Christmas. So it's like you get those 2 days off, presumably. So that's like 4 day weekend, right? And then it happens the next weekend too, Saturday, Sunday, Monday is New Year's Eve. Tuesday, New Year's Day. So, like, you get 4 more days off. Nope. I did nothing on Christmas, sort of. And then I'm going to Vancouver tomorrow for a Magic tournament. I'm going to be there, like, talking with people and playing games and stuff like that. And then I'm going to come back home Sunday night. And Monday, I'm going to work. Tuesday, I'm going to work. And then Wednesday, like, the new year begins officially. And, dude, where's the recharge time?
I don't know. You know, for both of us. Holidays can be family stuff is stressful. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I'm
politically correct. But also, no, I was my director of hitting. He got broken up with on Christmas Eve.
No,
he did.
Yes. God,
he got done dirty too. I won't get it. Jason got it done dirty to him, and he retaliated with a lot of just rough things. You know, like I'm not mad at you. I'm mad at myself for being fooled. And I'm just like, oh, you're going to give her that one? You're going to give her the dagger? And we went out for Scumbag Christmas on Christmas. I cooked and then I took off around 6 p.m. and I went out. We went to round one was open.
Okay.
And then we went to the casino and he won $1,500.
Hey, how about that? Okay, yeah. Bouncing back.
There you go. So it was Scumbag Christmas. So it was, we had a lot of fun.
Jeez.
And, for me, for people who don't know, which is probably everyone listening to this, the baseball... amateur side, it picks up the biggest time because the coaches have no time off also, except for the holidays. So all the conferences are scheduled in this 6 week block of time. So they can actually get away from their colleges and they can get away from their pro teams because there's no work, quote unquote.
Sure.
So as a result, all the conferences I have to go to are right now. So the first Friday after New Year's is the biggest trade show for baseball.
Okay.
So we're preparing for that. And actually, once it fell on January 6th, second and setup was on January 1st. So I actually just stayed over New Year's one time and it rang in New Year's while I was working with my number one first employee. So yeah, it's the 3rd of the 6th this year in Dallas. So we're all hands on deck trying to get ready for that. We got a 20 by 40 space. It's the biggest one we've had. So no, there's no time really down. Now is actually the busiest time. It's kind of cyclical in baseball. When baseball's going, we're slowest. Yeah.
Strange.
Yeah. But then, I mean, you're still, like you know, you're catching up on research, right? So, like, when you don't have any operational work, you accumulate all this technical debt, and then you got to pay it all back. Like, well, our systems could be better. We need to hire people. There's all that stuff. That's the downtime, you know? So there's never really any downtime. There's operational downtime, and then there's executive downtime, I guess. You know, our employees are like, hey, man, it's slow. Isn't it great? It's like... Yeah, no. Like, we need to replace some of you that we fired. we need to actually set up the business because when we are busy, we don't have time to actually do any business planning. You know, and that's the real thing of a business owner. You know, if you're not busy operationally, you're busy on the executive side. If you're any good at it,
yeah. I mean, it just there's always planning to be done, right? You know, we for Ultimate Guard, like we have our launch of our dice brand on January 4th. Which is very important. We have launch of our two biggest products in Q1 on February 1st. We got a trade show that's pretty huge to go to the second week of March. And it's just like, got to prepare for all that stuff, you know, to close out the year and make sure the Q1 goes smoothly and get ready for Q2 launches and everything too. So communicate with distributors, make sure retailers have what they need through our distributors, all the other stuff. So you would think like this is when things would slow down a little bit, but you know, we've got a lot of big plans for Q1 of next year and Q2 of next year and some very important product releases in the market that I work in. And it's just like, you know, I figured it might be a little bit slower to set everything up, but then like you want to make sure that everything transitions smoothly into the new year. And then you look at the Star City side where I manage 24 people, and it's like all of them have different demands and conversations they want to have, all part of the job, obviously. But like, you know, you have to talk with those people over what is supposed to be the slow time too, and make sure you're getting ready for Q1 of all that stuff too. So it's weird, like trying to find a downtime in a job or jobs like what you do or what I do. It almost feels like, because it's so entrepreneurial, that like, you know, you're not going to get like 2 weeks off. It's just not a thing.
No, I wish. Like I was telling you before the podcast, I'll take, I think, 2.5 to 3 weeks off traveling this year. And mostly I'll just be visiting places to get better at my job. Mostly I'll be visiting other facilities. We'll go visit a mutual friend, Zach Hill, in New York.
Yeah.
But the guys will be to visit the NFL front office.
Okay.
To talk about concussion research and all that. So one of a colleague, someone I know, is the concussion scientist for the NFL. So I just want to learn more about sports. So sure. That's not time off.
That's enjoyable, right? That's a time for you to like learn more, improve your job, all that stuff. So presumably it's not time off, but it kind of is because you get to focus on something that's not work.
Yeah, and I did take a week off this year.
So that was congratulations.
Good. I did. Yeah, I went to Mexico with my wife for our 10-year anniversary.
Very nice.
And I mean, I checked Slack. I was legitimately off, as off as you're gonna get, you know. So it was really nice, and I came back recharged, I guess. I don't know, I don't generally feel that way. Like I get burned out. I was burned out this year. I'll talk about that, I guess, now, for about a period of 28 hours because of a failed business deal with a major league team. And I hated it so much. I hated baseball so much. A mutual friend of ours and Cleveland pitcher Trevor Bauer,
yes.
One of his catchers, not a major league catcher, but a catcher that works with him in the offseason, left me a bottle of Gentleman Jack on my desk for helping him get a contract with the Padres. And he left it on there, and I came in, I'm like, that's a bad time for that to be here on my desk today. And I took it into the gym, and Trevor's like, you won't break that open right now, and start drinking. And I said, I didn't bring the red cups in here to show it off. And Trevor's like, I gotta go. Trevor drove straight to Nike, and then just he's like, I'm leaving. I don't want to see Kyle actually angry. So, and then I got over it. I crushed a meal at Daniels the next day, and I actually applied for other jobs though in that 28-hour period.
Yeah, so that's the interesting part of that story is like you were like so mad that you started just like it was that, so that reaction of like applying for other jobs, like what?
Yeah,
was
talk that about reaction? Talk about a fucking ridiculous thing.
Yeah,
like my stress reliever is to apply for more jobs.
Yeah, which is that makes no sense.
That's brutal. No, but I did have a long conversation with a mentor of mine, and it started making me think about what I'm going to do after baseball. Like after I sell this company in 10 years, if I do sell it, if that's a thing, I think probably I'll either work this, I'll have this job for a long time, like 30 years, and Driveline will dominate baseball, you know, in a lot of ways. Or we'll sell it to Nike, or we'll sell it to a sports science place down the line, you know. And so I've been thinking about like what I'm going to do. So I've actually been thinking about this for a while. So I do want to get into some other things that are personally interesting, and space flight was one of them. So I applied for a space startup in Austin, Texas, and I heard back, and we'll see. I'll actually be doing a little bit of contract stuff with them. I have actually some specialized computer resources. I have a Xeon Phi cluster. Like this person who runs the startup was asking for access to a Knights Landing platform, and I was like, I can't believe it. I actually have like a $5,000 server she was asking about.
Oh, wow.
I actually have one in my garage. So I'm going to give her access to that, and then that. And I'm going to fly down to Austin to meet with them. And I think it'd be cool because I actually need to start thinking about it, because probably like you, you have multiple jobs, but they're kind of in the same industry, but I think similar, and you can tell me if I'm wrong, but have trouble, and we're not very good at having hobbies, especially because your hobby is your work.
Yeah.
And I don't play Magic anymore at all, basically. And so having a hobby is tough. And it's always been hard for me, actually. And you, I think, as well.
Hobbies are... My hobby is, truthfully, watching basketball.
Yeah, no, that's true. Yeah, that's nice.
That's, like, my best hobby. The one that I can actually do while I'm also working, too. So
well, that's true.
So it's kind of convenient. Magic is in this, like, weird space where, like, it's kind of a hobby, but not a hobby. And, like, the reason I say that is because... Like, it is my work, and, like, this particular, like, this industry and this game is my work, right? So, can you still enjoy your hobby when it's all of your work? You know, you broadcast tournaments, you edit articles, you lay out a vision for a lot of the things that are going to be involved in Magic, and then you also are the marketing manager for, like, the biggest supply company for Magic.
Sure.
Can you still enjoy this as a hobby? If you don't do it very much, yes, which I think is kind of interesting. It's a credit to Wizards of the Coast because when I opened and played Arena for the first time a couple of days ago, I was like, holy shit, this is really, really fun. Like, it felt like I was playing Magic again and enjoying it. So that's been, like, kind of a revelation because, you know, it's right now in the winter, right? It's Vintage Cube season. Ultimate Masters is online. I played some of those each a little bit. And then the last two cubes I've done, I've dropped after one round. I've just been like, I don't care. I don't want to finish the rounds. I have other things to do. I don't know if it's like because I played Arena and then I went back to Magic Online and Magic Online is such shit that I was just like, I don't want to do this anymore. But like I had like, you know, various like fun cube decks. It's holiday cube season. We've been doing holiday cube forever. Mm-hmm. So normally it's a time where I get excited to like actually fire up and play a little Magic again. And then it's just like, nope, just going to drop because I'm not going to play these games. I don't really like my deck that much to keep playing. And yeah, I just like wasn't really interested. So it kind of comes and goes with me. Like Grand Prix Denver earlier this year when I played with Patrick and Ben Lundquist, ton of fun. I loved every minute of it. And we had a great tournament and I'd love to play with those guys again. But, you know, like grinding and all the other stuff like those, that's so far gone. But at the same time, all this opportunity that's coming with Magic now as an esport.
That's right.
Got to say it because it was in the article a lot.
That's right.
Now it's just like, am I too late? Do I want, like, is there value in being part of this and trying to get good at this again, all this other stuff? Because, like, reasonably, like, and you played Magic for a while, this is what every Magic player who's any good has wanted and waited for, right? They're, yeah, $10 million Pro Tour, they're injecting all these resources into it, everybody wants a piece of the puzzle. If you've been in competitive Magic for any amount of time, it's like, finally, yes! And it's just like, me, I'm just like, this is awesome, I don't have time for this.
No. Certainly not. I played Arena. I had the opposite. I thought it was a very good program. I thought it was cool. And I've been cubing because it's the only time I do play Magic. And Modo is terrible, but I don't know. I just, it really, it's not Arena, it's me. It's not you, it's me.
Yeah, sure, it's, sure.
I'm just never going to enjoy new sets of Magic because both of us learned the game when it was much different. And I still like that game. I still like the old Magic. And I know it's not coming back, and it shouldn't, honestly.
No, it's not coming back.
No, and it shouldn't, to be completely honest. I don't have any interest in it coming back. Like, I don't think it'll... Like, if I wanted to play, then I could play old school Magic. I can play Vintage. I can play all the formats that are becoming popular again due to the efforts of, like, Matt Sperling and others, you know? So if I want to play that version of Magic again, I can find the people who... I can go do that. And so that game is fundamentally a worse game than the current Magic. I am not so naive to believe that it's better. It's not. But it is the Magic that I like. And so I just don't like the new Magic. And I don't think I ever will. So while Arena's cool, it's just not for me, you know? And so I'm still playing Modo. I think it's great. I think it's needed. And I'm happy that it's going in that direction. We'll see if it actually works. Because Magic's problems are beyond the user interface, I think. And so I think changing the game, like being willing to change the game, which they've never wanted to do, and actively have fought it in the past, to have stuff like Crypt, obviously TSM Crypt, Cryptarian is now has its own thing. It just got announced on Arena today, which is cool. And then, you know, other formats, which they've always historically battled and now are finally kind of embracing.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a good strategy. But again, Magic's not for me. I would be way happier playing an old school tournament. You know, playing that old Type 1 format that Sperling and all the other old crotchety jerks play. That's me, though. I'm part of that. So, but I'm happy. I'm happy it's moving in the right direction.
It's really interesting. A thing that I've realized this year that is really new to me is I'm the kind of person who doesn't like to say no. if an opportunity comes along, I want to try to be a part of it. Hence the reason why I have two full-time jobs, right?
Yeah, I want to get into that.
Yeah.
Not necessarily, but just a new year, new me, new approach to solving problems.
Yes.
I like about that, but go ahead.
Yeah, so like, and this is kind of interesting for me, right? Where like, I've got all this responsibility, and like, I took this task on to see like what would happen in 2018. Like, how far can I push myself, and like, what are my boundaries?
And by that, you mean two jobs?
Yes. Yeah. Like, right. What are my boundaries? How much can I take on? Like, two full-time jobs. Do I actually have this in me to do this? I am right up against the wall of things that I could do now, where it's just like, I don't know if I have time to do this, but I hate saying no to stuff, right?
Yeah.
So it's eventually like, how long, like, because what's my shelf life on doing this? Like, I've always thought that like 2 years, maybe, right? I think I can handle this for 2 years, but I'd have to have some serious talks with myself of like, what kind of damage am I doing to like my long-term mental stability or like my physical health? I still go to the gym a lot and everything like that, but like, I am tired a lot, and I don't think that's that healthy. So now, like, you know, as this arena thing has come up and like Magic is growing as an esports, that's more opportunity. So eventually you have to do the thing that I've never really wanted to do, which is tell people, hey, I don't have time for that. Or, hey, I can't do this thing anymore. You know, does that mean that like I can still continue to be the editor of the website and do coverage and be the North American marketing manager for Ultimate Guard? Realistically, probably not. I don't like, this was a lot this year, and I found some time for some vacation, and I only got sick like twice. So I think my body held up pretty well. But like, you know, at some point you just have to say, hey, I don't have time to do this thing. And I've always heard people and businesswomen say that, right? Where it's like, you have to selectively pick your opportunities now once you get a lot of them.
Yeah, no, that's true.
And you realistically can't do everything. And I am finding out that firsthand that like, yeah, as much as you want to be able to do everything, you can't. And so you have to be selective with what you pick up and put down. And man, I'm learning that a lot as I transition in 2019, where Arena's come along. There's been so much opportunity. So many more people have contacted me about other things involved in this sphere. And it's like, shit, I can't do everything. No matter how many people that like I might bring on board, right? Like,
Yeah.
I have an assistant. I have someone who does all my graphic design. I have someone who edits all my podcasts. You know, I'm opening an apparel store, all this other stuff. But like, I can't do all this stuff. And that's really interesting to me because I always want to do all the stuff.
Yeah, I think we're in the same spot. And in research and, you know, for those who don't know, I'm the director of research and development of my company, and that's primarily my day-to-day responsibilities on top of being the president. But like, that's a big problem in R&D because we have a lot of 20-something, older, late 20s people, and I'm 35, and we're running essentially the new frontier for baseball. Like, I don't know if this is necessarily exactly accurate, but we're definitely the plurality, if not the majority, of new baseball initiatives that are introduced to like pro ball and whatever come from us. You know, we do a lot of the cutting edge development of a lot of the work out there, whether it's pitch design work or high speed videography or biomechanics, stuff like that. It comes from our lab. So we're like we're the forefront runner of it, and we're way ahead of most major league teams, which is actually a liability. For this reason, it's because all these kids think that they can keep adding work, and by kids, I mean me too. And suddenly we have a huge slate of research projects that are like all half started and not done. So the throughput, when you knock down a few walls, it becomes easy. But then as we're discovering new knowledge, it just gets much more difficult, right? It's asymptotically, it's a power law, right? Of how hard it gets. So then you have to start picking what projects are we going to do? How are we going to make meaningful progress towards it and then chip away at it? And then that means we have to discard the rest. You know, essentially we have to choose a couple cards in our hand. The rest got to go. You know, and we got to play to the strengths and hammer one thing down, which is inherently not anything people want to do because they want to think, here's all the possibilities. Are you kidding? We're going to give up on mapping the brain for like predicting pitches for a hitter. Like that's like an initiative we have. We have all the tools for it, thousands of dollars worth of equipment, and we're just going to give up. It's like, well, no, that's the way that it comes across, but that's not the way that it really is. The way is like, if we keep doing that, then we're not going to do anything. We're not going to get anything done, you know? So that's a big planning thing we're doing in 3 weeks after I get back from the trade show. It's like, here's the number of labor hours. Now it's time to assign projects. The projects will take these amount of hours, of which we'll underestimate. Mm-hmm. We're definitely going to get that wrong, but at least we have something. And then it's like, okay, then as soon as we run out of X hours, then that's it. Everything else gets cut. Like, so we're going to have to figure out what's a priority. So that's what's happening here. And then, as far as the new year, new me, what I'm trying to do is I told you this before we came on the podcast, an unnamed MLB team. I've bitched that MLB teams do a lot of things very poorly. I will continue to bitch. So that is the new year, new me in 2025, maybe, that I won't bitch about that. That's not going to happen. As a sidebar, my mentor from Pro Ball this year at the winter meetings told me, you know, on Sundays, you just shouldn't tweet on Sundays. It'd be like the Lord's Day. It'd be like a day of rest. And then you'll find that you don't need Twitter, and then you'll stop tweeting on Wednesdays, and then you'll slowly not tweet. And I said, I will do that if you make me the big league pitching coach. You'll note that I'm still tweeting on Sundays. So it hasn't that hasn't worked out. So you don't get to make demands of me and then don't get to return. You know, that's not how this works. So basically, I instead of bitching nonstop and not doing anything about it, I've just decided that I'm at a point in my life where I want to not... I really hate complaining and not doing things about it. I always have.
Yeah, but, I can't stand that.
Right, but nothing could be more American than complaining. Because the problem with getting successful in your industry is that suddenly you have a responsibility. Like, it's like, oh, I can't believe, wouldn't it be great if major league teams acted this way? It's like, who's going to do that besides me? You know, if it involves like sports science or whatever, it's like, ah, oh, fuck, right. So, like, actually, I'm just complaining about myself.
Yep.
So I'm moving to a situation where I'm like emailing the teams and actually being much more diplomatic about wanting to work with them. Like, our director of hitting signed a groundbreaking deal with the Philadelphia Phillies where he remains employed at Driveline Baseball, but is also the hitting coordinator, and he's the highest paid hitting coordinator, right? Like, that's a huge win for everyone because the salaries need to go up. It would mean a lot different, a more diverse pool, like more professional. I think the coaching would get a lot better. But anyway, like, expecting that that's the only vehicle is silly. Like, I should be able to work with major league teams in a much more flexible way. And hopefully they see it that way too. So that's like, instead of just complaining, I'm actually trying to be at least. And then at the end of the day, when the teams all say no, because they're going to, they're not that flexible. They don't want to change that bad. Because I'm still cynical. But at the end of the day, I can be like, you know what? Instead of just bitching, I actually really tried to like solve the problem. And at least maybe someone heard the idea, and down the line, like, we'll actually get some stuff done. And so that's the difference between me today and me last year, which is like, instead of just like complaining, like, let's figure out ways that might actually solve the problem. But the biggest issue in baseball, and I'll stop after this since it's not a baseball podcast.
Hey, it's an everything podcast.
Is that what bothers me, the CEO of Stripe Payments, I don't know if you're familiar with them.
Yeah.
Okay, so Stripe, we use them. I've actually emailed back and forth with the CEO back in the long, long, long ago before it was called Stripe. It's called Dev/Payments. And he's famous for being hands-on, and like, that's what he credits a lot of the work for, doing a lot of the shit work himself when he was starting the company. And I can attest to it. I have emails in my email box from 11 years ago or whatever it was, where I think 8 years ago when he was starting, Patrick Collison. He was recently on the Tim Ferriss podcast, and Patrick talked about, you know, when someone comes up to you with a diametrically opposed worldview, like, Patrick is very pro-immigration. He's from Ireland. He moves here to America, so he's personally benefited, but he's also, like, I've read a lot of books on it. I think it makes sense to have more open borders than not, and whatever, right? We don't have to get into the specifics, but he's like, but when I run into someone who I think is smart, but anti-immigration, instead of just writing them off, I try to figure out why, and also instead of trying to figure out what the argument is, I try to figure out what events in that person's life would make them think that way, why do they think this way, why would they do this, that it makes sense, because it doesn't to me. You know, but like, it's true, like, empathy, trying to figure out, like, what is the process I went through, and then perhaps from that I can learn a little bit more about, and maybe that will strengthen my argument, maybe it'll change my mind, whatever, right? And this is all going in a humorous way, I promise. I've thought about this, about general managers and everyone that are not the Houston Astros.
Okay.
And if anyone is listening to this, fuck you guys. You guys are just, like, absolutely wrong. Like, I've tried to have this empathy, and it's frustrating. It would be like watching it. I can't describe how much further ahead the Astros are than anyone. Like, because they traded minor league players for Justin Verlander and Gerrit Cole, two number one pitchers.
Yep. Right?
Outstanding. They still have their number one prospect, a hitter, and their number one pitching prospect. So they didn't have to trade either of the best prospects to get the best pitchers in baseball. So this should make you think. If you were a boss and someone of another industry and someone was able to pull off that kind of coup, you would just be like, how did that happen? You know, you would look into it. You would read like your Baseball America. Like, in Baseball America, there's still like the number top five farm system in baseball.
And like the best team in baseball.
Won 100 games 2 years in a row, won the World Series, and were, I think, the best team in the AL. They lost the Red Sox. It happens. Red Sox had a great team too.
Yep.
You know, and a bunch of their star players had bad years this year. Like, Altuve, Correa was hurt, McCullers was hurt. Like, it's just a lot of, like, bad, quote-unquote bad things happened to them, and they still won 100 games, right? And so, if I read that and saw this year, and I was, like, the owner, of the Mariners or whatever, I would just be like, can you call everyone in the office? Like, you guys are all fired. What the fuck? You know, like, how is this possible? And I actually had a meeting with my partner today where he's like, you get this less. He's telling me, he's like, you, Kyle, get this less than anyone else that I know, because you do not have an emotional decision making capability. You have removed that. You don't, you cannot make decisions emotionally. And I said, yes, I know. He's like, well, that's why you don't understand. And I'm like, well, how did the GMs not get it? And it's really frustrating as a business owner that I've like really removed the emotional component. And it's really served me very well from baseball, because it helps me take the other side of arguments and figure out why people think the way they do. You obviously see me do this on Facebook all the time. Yep. On both sides of it.
Quite a bit, yes.
Yeah, and I can't stress how important it is to, when I stop writing people off for having views and like removing emotion as much as possible, I became so much better of a business owner. I became so much more effective at my job. I became so much better of a salesperson because I understood their needs. I understood why they thought things were stupid. So instead of taking them personally, you know, and I certainly yell at people on the internet. You've seen that as well. But at the end of the day, like, a lot of the times, the legacy people in your industry just haven't had the question framed the right way. So when you get into their mind and figure out, like, hey, I'm not saying you're shitty at your job or you're stupid. Like, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, like, you do a good job, but, like, you need to, like, think about it a different way, or we need to help address your needs a little bit differently. And so that's kind of what I've been flexing a lot more recently, is trying to have a little bit more empathy for people, because I'm going to be old very soon here as well when it comes to technology. And yeah, it's been interesting. It's been really cool to take that side of it. And I think actually my business has exploded in growth largely because of our ability that I've influenced the staff to really think that way, because we are, if we are the cutting edge of anything, you're going to run into everyone in the industry who by kind of default don't agree, because like they just haven't been exposed to it. And so you can be combative, which I think you have to be at the beginning, because you have to get a foothold. But then if you're going to win over the entire market or enough of it anyway, you're going to have to take some effort. You're going to have to give some ground. You're going to take an L here or there. And it doesn't mean, you know, it doesn't mean that you're wrong. It just means that like that has to just be part of your strategy. Like that's it's tactical to be wrong, I guess. So that's one of the biggest things I learned in this year-end podcast. Talk about new year, new me.
Yes. The empathy thing is interesting. I think it's interesting to me because like the work is stressful, and I feel like a lot of the time people are like complaining just to complain a lot of the time. So it's like kind of hard to have empathy in some situations when like it's probably there's more to it than the actual complaint. There's probably more underneath what's going on. And I find that kind of to be like kind of interesting, because like I'm so like pedal to the metal, to the floor, like no excuses, no bullshit. Like if I can do it, you can do it, that kind of thing. So, you know, when someone's just like, hey, my article is going to be late today, it's just like, well, what the fuck? You know, sure. Like, why can't you do your shit on time? I don't understand. I can juggle all of these plates in the air. And so it's just like, should I be empathetic? Probably. Is it hard? Yeah. But like, it's also something I want to work on too, because it's just like, well, I mean, what the fuck, guys, right? Like, I'm not even, like, calling anybody names or anything like that, but it's just, like, I see a lot of stuff, especially in this sphere, where it's, like, hard for me to be empathetic, but I'm trying to be better about it. Because I'm so wired as no excuses, no bullshit. You can do anything that you actually want to do. Also, there's stuff, but then it's just, like, maybe that's not true for some people.
Yeah, I think it's a tough situation, because I think both of us have a fairly unique perspective on it in different ways, because obviously neither of us are white, if people don't know that. So, and while I absolutely agree that it's harder, it's certainly harder for certain people, you know, black people yourself, obviously, and whatever, there's a lot of racial pressures and stuff like that, especially where we grew up in Cleveland, to do things and to do things differently and whatever. A lot of it is frustrating because it can be like a really frustrating, like excuses as far as like, oh, not everyone can do it. I was born behind the eight ball and yada, yada. But both of us have like fairly mediocre upbringings at for given whatever. And a lot of it is both of us are wired the way to have no excuses. It's a very deterministic universe. There's nothing random necessarily. Ultimately, yes, random things happen, but we can control our own destiny. And that's what you hear from a lot of these like really motivational accounts, like these Twitter and Instagram accounts are, you can do anything and there's no luck in the world. It's like, that's obviously bullshit, obviously.
Well, it's obviously not true.
Right, yes. Yeah. Some people are more like, neither of us were born to wealth and both of us are not white. So, like, that's not great. But it would have been better if both of us were born rich and white. That would have been good.
I wouldn't have minded that.
Right, no, that would have been fine. But at the end of the day, like, it just, like, it would, the world would be a better place if everyone believed, what is not true, by the way, that you have ultimate control of your destiny, then that no one has, you have no control of your destiny. Because, like, there's just a shitload of stuff that's out of your hands, and you're born into poverty, or you're born into, like, a bad situation. And, like, some of that shit, it is what it is, right? So, like, globally, I think there's a big difference between thinking globally, like, I'd say to say, like, what's best for the human race and what's happened to you. Right, so Zach Hill, our good friend, likes to say, you are not beholden to a good life. Like, you don't deserve that. Like, why would that be a thing that you deserve that? Like, maybe in a future America, but like the current setup is not such that like everyone gets to have a nice life. Like, that just it, so like that has to go away, that thought. And like, should that be true? No. Like, it should not be true. It should be true that everyone, there's basic income, there's universal health care, racism and prejudice is actively fought on the front lines every day, right? All of that stuff should be true, and we should work towards that goal and recognize that people from minority backgrounds and protected classes do not have it as easy as Spencer, whatever the fuck, who was born to $1 million in wealth in upstate New York. Absolutely. We should absolutely calibrate for that. Probably hire based on that, probably accept people to college based on that, whether you want to call it affirmative action or whatever. Like, we should calibrate for that. But at the end of the day, you live your own life. Like, you are in this situation, you get one bullet, and I was born in 1983, and if I was born in 2083, maybe it would be a lot different, you know? But like, at the end of the day, I have to live with the prejudices, you have to live with the prejudices. I'm not trying to say who has it worse, but like, we both have to deal with racial expectations and our upbringing and where we're from. No matter what the fuck should be true, it doesn't matter, right? So, like, a lot of it is just, yes, is it, do you have it worse because you're black and people have issues with that and, like, prejudice? Absolutely. I assume that's true. I'm not black. I don't know. But, yes, you probably do. Does that stop you from working your ass off? No, certainly not, right? And, in fact, probably, like, dealing with that adversity at a young age and throughout your whole life probably has helped in that regard. You know, I think you would probably say that.
Yeah, it's hard to argue otherwise.
Right. And so, like, societal pressure on me being Asian, like, oh, you should be good at math and this and this and this or whatever, which are, like, good stereotypes, quote unquote, but then also pigeonhole. You can't be an athlete. How the fuck do you run a baseball business? What do you know about that? You know, like, all those types of things I get still to this day, you know, just because of the angle of my eyes, right? You know? So a lot of it is, yes, you can deal with, like, yes, that probably shouldn't be true, but it is. You know, and so, like, whatever. Like, it's next pitch. It's just, like, you have to deal with the hand you're dealt now. So that's the thing that frustrates me and is, frankly, actually a terrifying thing to talk to people about and try to figure out how to get that across. Because we have, for baseball anyway, we have that's not a good word, but we have a diverse research and development department. Racially, we have Indian, Asian, white, black, and then also women. We have quite a few women who work, including a high school girl, high school girl. She's 17.
Yeah, so you talked about it last time.
Yeah, and our electrical engineer is one of the best electrical engineers. She's brilliant, and she's a woman, and she's great. She's great. And so talking to them to get, like, their perspective, and not, we didn't hire them because they're women. They're the best candidates, and we have a diverse pool, and we take pride in that, you know, so, because I think it's a big strength. I wrote a personal blog, like, if me and you have the exact same knowledge of magic, or it doesn't matter, of X, but you and I took vastly different paths to get there, like, given your upbringing and mine, different racial dynamics, different school dynamics, different how we got there, how we learned, whether you were professionally educated and I was self-educated, whatever, right? Like, if you take different paths, and then both of us, and then we work at the same company or organization, and we have a problem with X, a task that we're masters at, because we've both taken different ways of getting there, our chances of solving the problem are so much greater if we have a diverse background. Because how we think about how we got to that path is actually what's really important, not actually having this value of 100 out of 100 of a mastery. It's like how we got to the 100 is super important. And so, like, that's honestly been a huge strength of the research department at Driveline Baseball, and why, like, having a diverse hiring funnel is really important, right? But then there's unique challenges that each individual dealt with to get there, right? Like, our electrical engineer is a woman. You can't possibly know anything about math, and you're a woman, and you should, and she's from the South, right? She's just dealt with just incredible sexism, right?
Yeah.
And it's just, it's interesting to see, but like at the end of the day, she's just like, whatever, like, I'm interested in mechanical engineering and electrical engineering, so I'm just gonna do that. I'm interested in chasing storms. I'm interested in being a DJ. She is, you know, and like, do I have to work twice as hard? Sure, absolutely. Or whatever, multiple. Yeah, but like, what's my alternative? To not do it? To give in? You know, and like, that's been the frustrating piece of advice. Both of us are staring at a list of questions we've gotten on Instagram and Twitter. And that just is a recurring question for you. I'm sure it is for me. Right, like, how do you, whether it's racially whatever driven, it's just like, this is, it's really hard to go through as adversity. How do you deal with that or whatever? It's like, well, if you haven't dealt with it, a lot of it is, if you haven't dealt with adversity at a young age, then you're just not equipped to deal with any adversity later in life. So it's I don't know, what do you think about that as far as your path to getting into streaming, or how hard that was? You know, because we didn't grow up in a diverse, let's put it this way, we didn't grow up in a diverse our friends group is not the most diverse group from where we're from.
I wouldn't say it's the most diverse group of people. Still friends with them, but definitely not the most diverse
group. They're not bad. But yeah, us leaving really did a huge damage to the diversity quotient of Cleveland, Ohio Magic players.
I think I would agree with that.
Yeah, me, you, and Saran leaving just fucking immediately. That's brutal. That was a brutal situation.
I don't know. It's interesting, right? Like, in a situation where, you know, a lot of people, the question that I think is most common is just like, you know, how do you get started or whatever, right? Like, that's the one that comes up the most. And, you know, when there's so many reasons for you not to get started, or so many potential things that you can see, like, you can see so many different avenues to failure. And to me, it's just like, I don't know, you just do it because you want to do it, right? And whatever happens, happens. Like, you bring up the electrical engineer, the woman that works for you. It's just like, oh, this is what I want to do, so I'm going to do it. I'm going to figure it out. And like, maybe it works, maybe it doesn't. But like, I'm not going to figure it out unless I don't, try, right? So. Yeah. That's kind of always just been my mindset. If I think you can find every excuse in the book to not be able to do something. And that's why sometimes I get frustrated when people say like, oh, I can't like complete this task today for whatever reason. It's like, well, why can't you? Like, did you not manage your time well? Or like, did something in life come up? Or like, it's physically difficult, excuse me, it's mentally difficult for me to like understand why someone is unable to do something, because I don't ever view things through that spectrum. Right? Like, I'm trying to do everything that I can all of the time. And so it's so hard for me to like, it is painful for me to like cancel an appointment. Cause it's just like, I have time. I can make it there in 13 minutes. And it's like, actually the drive is 27 minutes. And it's like, I could be there.
I can do it.
I can make it. And then I can get this in. And then I can then head back to the office, like get that taken care of. And I can get this taken care of. And it's like, I can do all these things. And it's like, is that living in reality? I don't know. The answer is probably no. But like, maybe I can manage my time a little better. Maybe I can sleep a little bit less. Maybe I can be more efficient. Maybe, you know, scrolling through the Twitter timeline one time instead of four times over the course of the day saves me a little bit of time, so on and so forth. But at the same time, like, if you are that focused on that one thing, like, what are the things that you are not doing otherwise? Like, are you taking time to like take a fucking breath?
Yeah.
You know, like stuff like that. So when someone, so like one of the things that like I've kind of resolved myself into doing for next year, you know, you said new year, new me a little while ago, it's just like, don't get so upset when someone's unable to complete something when you expect for it to be done, you know, or like things happen. Not everyone is wired the same way that I am. So, you know, if it's just like, hey man, like I can't get this done today just because I can't. And it's like, okay, that's fine. You know, like, and not get frustrated or upset about it, and just kind of be empathetic about it, and just realize that, like, hey, like, not everyone's going to work 18 hours a day like you are. Yeah. Because not everyone wants to do that.
No, it's stupid. We're the dumb ones.
You know? Like, yeah. Like, and that's the biggest thing for me. It's like, every time I see someone, it's just like, a lot of the time, like, mentally, where I get frustrated is when someone just says they can't do something, or, like, it's just a thing where it's just like, if I feel like people are making excuses a lot of the time, or settling for mediocrity, where I refuse to do either of those things, but maybe they're okay with that, and maybe I should be more okay with that. I don't know.
Yeah.
I think that conversation is very interesting. Like, as an example, I got sixth place at Grand Prix Denver.
Yep.
I was fucking mad.
Yeah.
A lot of people would be really happy, but that's one match short of the Pro Tour. That's $700 I don't care about. Because I was there for a very particular thing, which is qualifying. I don't give a shit about the pro points, all this other stuff, where a lot of people would be really happy with a sixth place finish. I'm mad. And so part of me, when I see people finish like in the top 32 of like an event, and they're just like, dude, I got 28th place. This is so awesome. My first visual reaction is just like, that sucks. Yeah. Why would you be happy about that? That's not first. That's not top eight. Like, those are the metrics. That's not top 16. Why are you happy with that place? And it's like, well, everyone's like bar and what they're trying to accomplish is different. Like, even when I first started playing Magic, started playing competitive Magic, I was not happy like getting 20th place. I was not happy getting 13th place at things. Like, I wanted to be in the top eight, or I wanted to win the tournament, things like that. But for some people, it's like, hey, this is just like a stepping stone into another thing. So like, I can be happy about this result. But then there's also the mindset of, well, if you're happy with like 28th place, what's ever going to get you to fourth place?
Sure.
If you're happy with 28th. And so I look at that and I'm just like, well, if you're happy with like your article being late, what's ever going to make you do it on time? Yeah. If you don't plan accordingly and manage your time appropriately, then you're never going to get to try where you get to. You say that you want to be a really popular person in Magic, and you say that you want to be like the most read author, but like, you don't even turn your shit in on time.
Right.
So like,
that's the biggest problem, right?
It's yeah.
People that say,
yeah, and they do Y, right? Yeah, they say X and they do Y, but yeah, like, right. Are they doing Y because like they're lazy? Are they doing Y because like they're just incapable? Like, what is the explanation for I want to do X, but it ends up being Y? And like, why am I getting so upset about Y?
Well, you know, I think I actually think that's a valid reason to be angry and like and dissatisfied with people. But like, yeah, and people should know, hearing this, is like, neither Cedric nor I think that like our lifestyles are optimal.
No, I think what we do is borderline stupid and insane. Yeah,
but the point of this podcast episode, at least, is to talk. There are a lot of people who want to be entrepreneurs or work as hard and just need a little direction. So, like, that's to color that. Most people who are full time, like people who work for me, work 50 hours a week and then like have hobbies and go hiking and take vacations, and that's fine, you know. And then they don't have the exact same output as me, but like, they're not supposed to. Like, I'm not hiring for that. The problem that, but that's a different problem. At no point do those employees ever pretend to want otherwise. Like, that's so they, as far as I'm concerned, we set expectations. They meet and exceed those expectations almost always. I write the reviews. I give them raises. We have profit sharing. They get hooked up, and we take care of our employees very well, have health care and all that. And they deserve every penny and more from that. And they usually get it at the reviews. And generally speaking, like, someone did something really good at my job, and I just put the review, I emailed it to him, I took him out to coffee, and I just said, look, what the fuck do you want? I lose. I just told the guy to go, I'm like, I said, I lose. I said, you win. What is it you want? You know, like, let's come up with reasonable, hopefully, for the company's goals and all that. But like, when you talk about salary increase or whatever, I lose. Just say it. You know, like, say what you want, because you've accomplished everything and been an A player, you know. But some people aren't necessarily that way, and they're still super valuable employees. I'd be pissed if they, I'd be sad if they quit. You know, I wonder if I could do something to retain them. You know, what could I have done better to keep that person who's a quote-unquote mediocre employee? But they're consistent, usually. That's the thing, is these people are usually much more consistent than you and I. Like, they're much more consistent at work output and like what they do, whereas you and I are very streaky in our work, just because like what we do is inherently like that. So this podcast, hopefully, and the questions that we'll start reading at some point are talking about like people that want to make that leap from zero to one. And you still got to read that book, Peter. I told you about that.
I know that.
Yeah, it's fine.
You want me to find time to read a book?
You find time to read a book because, you know, the best CEOs read 40 books a year.
Yeah, well, that's stop. That can't be true.
Not accurate.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's total bullshit. All the great self-help advice on Twitter from at Warren Buffett 38.
Yeah.
You know, just
yeah.
So,
that's shit that drives me fucking nuts.
People, I don't think there's like, anything that makes me more irrationally angry than reading that stuff.
People with like their inspirational bullshit that haven't done anything drives me nuts.
Oh yeah,
it just drives me nuts.
Yeah, a guy like David Goggins or whatever, it's like, all right, that guy probably very hard to be a Navy CEO. You know, I don't even exactly know what he's done. I know he's been in the highest echelons of the military. He's a badass ultramarathon runner, all that. He's tackled some of the hardest physical and mental problems that you know to have. That guy can say whatever the fuck he wants about inspiration or whatever. And generally speaking, David actually says a lot of the same stuff that we do, which is like, you just don't need it. you know, just like, do the work or not. And it is frustrating. So I think to get into more of the entrepreneurship stuff, like, if people are actually interested in owning their own destiny, it's very popular. You have the people who are like way too positive about it. Like, this is great and it was my best life and I get to do whatever. You have people that are way too negative, like you and I. Because, like, there has to be some balance of the force. And I think both of us talk about how shitty it is and whatever. But at the end of the day, it's pretty fucking great, obviously, to set our own schedules, to do whatever we want. And by setting our own schedules, I mean, it's just work always. Yeah. But the flexibility, there are a lot of people who can't just like go home to see their mom if they're sick or my uncle passes away or whatever, you know, like that we have ultimate flexibility in that regard. You know, like we'll be working when we're not at the hospital or at the funeral, you know, yeah. That's part of it. But like, there's a lot of people who don't have that. And I think that's attractive to them. And I think it would be ignorant to just not talk about like some of the ways that, you know, we got there. And so I think that's an interesting kind of branching point. As far as streaming, you know, taking the leap to, or just whatever, but taking the leap to like, what do you want to do? Like, what is it that made you want to really get into the streaming side of it? Again, we've talked about the last podcast, how dumb I thought you were to get into it. Like, there's just going to be no future and all that. But why stick with it even when you weren't getting daily motivational, like your Twitch streams numbers were low. They didn't ever shoot up or whatever. And there was no linchpin. Like, nothing ever happened where it was like, and finally I've made it, you know, at least in my experience watching you, you know, it's like, just eventually you rolled into roles that made sense because you had all this experience. But like, what, why keep going? Why do that?
Well, like, I it's like, for me with,
which is what I think a lot of people want to know.
Well, like that, with me that, yeah. For streaming or just like anything, like, you know, let's talk about like, you know, being content coordinator of the website or, like, like kind of guiding the vision of the SCD tour. It's just like, I don't know. I believe in something and I'm big on, it's what you talked about earlier. It's like, I'm big on no complaints and just making it happen. And so like with the streaming thing, right? Like I had nothing else to do, but I was like, I'm pretty confident that like, this is the right thing to do. And this is the way to go. And like, once I'm confident in myself and a vision, like I'm just going to do it. And I don't really give a fuck what anybody else says. Like I'll ask for advice from people I trust. I'll talk to you. I'll talk [S2] Sure. [S1] To Joe. I'll talk to Jerry. I'll talk to people who I know, who I think are very smart and whose opinions I value and stuff like that. But like once I've done like my research and I think a certain way about something, like I'm going to fucking do it. And I hope there are people who think that what I'm doing is stupid, because that's just more of a motivator. So, you know, like, trust me when I say you are not the only person who thought like what I was doing was really dumb.
No, I thought it was dumb, but I thought the way you went about it was very smart. Because I think I told you that. I think I did. Because you're just like, I have a plan. The future of Magic is going to look like this. The future of TV is going to look like this. And I said, I'm not qualified to say whether that's right or not. I don't know. I think that's not a great idea, but that's not also not what I was evaluating. Like when you laid it out, I said, fuck, well, that's, you have a plan. So whatever.
Yeah. I don't know.
Like, I thought it was good. It was very methodical. It was very planned. And you're just like, this is the direction I'm going to go. And, I don't know if you have an exit strategy, if it wasn't going to work out, but I don't think we talked about that, but we did the way that you went about your business. I admire very much.
Well, I think it's just kind of interesting, right? Because like you can come up with first of all, there's like multiple pieces of the puzzle. First of all, I just don't think people plan. I think people just do. Like, is that good? Is that bad? I don't know, but it's a huge pet peeve of mine, which is just like, hey, I want to start streaming. Okay. That's like neat. There's like, have you done any like research about like how to do this? Why it would be beneficial? Why would someone want to watch your stream? Like right now, there's like this huge arms race in Magic, right? Yeah, for streaming. Like, of course. You know, you've got the MPL, there's 32 people who have to stream. And then there's like, there's just left and right. You've got all these people who are just like, hey, I'm buying a new computer. I'm going to start streaming all this other stuff. And it's like, okay, well, let's think about this for a minute. 32 people who are way better at you in Magic have to stream. Right. That's literally, they're contractually obligated to stream. And then there's already people whose feet are very much set in the streaming area, like Numot and Caleb Durward, and a bunch of other people, right? And then you've also got these Hearthstone. Yeah, well, MJ doesn't do it much anymore, but he still streams a little bit. But then you've also got these Hearthstone people that are being paid to stream now, and like they have their viewership and all these things. So
and they're excellent at streaming.
Yeah, and they're good at this. Yeah,
whether Magic is, but I mean, they understand the ecosystem.
Yeah, so it's like, okay, so like all these people who are outside of like these top 32 and these Hearthstone people who do this for a living. And some other people who are already established, like Numont and these things. Like, for the other people who are going to start streaming, why are you doing this? I'm not saying you shouldn't do it, but have you asked yourself the question why? If the answer is, I want to do it just because I want to fucking do it, fine. That's totally fine. Like, don't get mad if you don't get any viewers, right? If the answer is I want to try this and see what happens, also fine. If the answer is like, I'm passionate about this and I think I want to do this for a living and I see people like Ninja and Numot and all these streamers making a lot of money and like this seems like a fun career to pursue. There's a guy I know in Atlanta named Brian Easton who decided to do that. And I was like, dude, you want to do that? Go for it. And a bunch of people are just like, dude, that's a really bad idea. That's super hard. It's, you know, not profitable. And it's like, well, you don't even know if it's about the profit for him. Maybe he just hates working his fucking job and he likes playing Hearthstone and he wants to play Hearthstone in front of an audience, which is totally fine.
Yeah.
You know? But I think a lot of the time people don't ask themselves, like, why am I doing this? Why do I want to do this? Okay, after you answer the why,
What is your plan of execution, given what you're trying to accomplish when you're doing this? Let's say that, hey, I want to be like the next big streamer. My goal is to be the Ninja of Magic. Okay. What is your plan to do that? Like, what is your competition? I've already listed it off with the MPL and everything like that. So, like, is this reasonable to try to jump into this now? I don't think people ask themselves that. If they want to jump into this, what's their plan to stand out, to actually be different, to be good at what they do? You know, you take your company as an example. What makes Driveline different from other people who have tried to enter this sphere? What's going to make a difference that when you come knocking to the Mariners, they're going to go like, oh, I'm actually going to have to listen to what you have to say.
Yeah.
You know, because all the time when I work for Star City and Ultimate Guard, all the time people are like, yo, you want to sponsor me? Why? Why would I do that?
Yeah.
Well, I like Magic and people watch my stream and I'm going to stream a bunch. Okay. You know that a lot of people ask the same question who are way more qualified than you and I tell them no?
Right.
You know, like, do you, like, and that's a thing that, like, drives me nuts. It's just like, if I were to go to, here's another example. People submit, I get submissions all the time for articles, right? Hey, just curious if you're taking any writers. I'm just going to delete that now. That's not anything. That's not anything. And I want to send back to the person. I was like, if you were writing in sports, would you send an email to ESPN and expect the ESPN to go? Absolutely.
Yeah, would you send that email to Bill Simmons?
Yeah, would you send
that? Could be on the BS podcast?
Yeah, absolutely. What are your qualifications? I like sports.
Sincerely,
yes.
Patrick Phillips.
Yeah. So, like, I got like an email for an article today that's just like, hey, so curious if you guys are, like, taking on writers, and, like, I didn't really edit this article. It probably needs some heavy editing, but, like, I want you to take a look. And it's like, well, like, really?
Yeah.
Is this like your best shot? Is this you throwing your best punch? Because, like, if it is, I think you need to reevaluate your best punch. Like, that's how my brain works. It's like, I get this and I'm just like, this is a waste of my time. Why would you come to me this way? But then, and so then I start to get mad. But then I decide, like, maybe I shouldn't get mad because maybe this is the best, this person knows how to do this, right?
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't do it this way. I would never send something to, like, a professional outfit where it's just like, hey, I want to work here. And I didn't really read this and I didn't really edit it. And I didn't really put a lot of thought into it. But you should take this seriously. And it's just like, well, should they though? Because I don't think they should.
The problems are the expectations. You should be mad at the expectations that have been set in society, which are not that you can do everyone. You do everything and all this trophy. Participation trophy. I don't believe that stuff. But I do believe that people feel that all work should be paid for. Like that, and that you should not have to do stuff. People, by and large, feel that that there's a very deterministic relationship. Like, if I do something, I should be paid for it. If I do something, there should be this. Businesses should take a chance. Like, these types of things. It's just like, that's not the economy. That's not the world we live in anymore. Like, it just isn't. You know, like, first of all, like, labor is not loyal anymore. I wasn't when I was working in the labor force. I had many jobs. I think I've had, like, over 25 jobs. Because people know that that's the way to get promoted. You can't stay at a job anymore and get promoted. Like, it just doesn't work. Like, a lot of times you have to move on and move to a different place. And me, speaking as a business owner, I have to compete for my labor. I have to offer the best. I have to offer the best salaries, the best healthcare, the best working environment, because people don't just care about money anymore. You know, people want to be fulfilled at their job, which is not the case 60 years ago. You know, today it's like, I want to go to work and I want to feel empowered by my job. I want to feel fulfilled. I'm not saying they're wrong. I felt that way. That's why I got out of IT. You know, that's why you got out of insurance selling.
Oh, God. That, you know? Please don't remind me.
Well, exactly. Right? Oh, so people don't want just the money, right? Both of us were making, actually, not that, but I was making more money salary-wise in my previous job than I ever was here, you know? And I will probably for a long time. So people want to be fulfilled. So you have to compete for the labor, and I think that's good. And from a business owner, like, I'm competing every day to keep my employees. I truly believe that, and that's great. But at the end of the day, like, if you want to get into a desirable place to work, whether it's Star City Games or Driveline Baseball, we have a ton of applicants for every open position. I'm sure you do too. I mean, for writing and all that, right? So, like, there's this idea that I shouldn't have to do much to get in there. And that's, like, that's got to go. Like, that's got to go away. And I know that unpaid internships are unfair, and we've already talked about all that. But, like, at the end of the day, if you're going to throw your best punch to do that, you're probably going to have to write at a crappy place, a blog that no one notices. You're going to have to hone your writing skills. You're going to get one comment a month. You know, but, like, that's what's got to happen. Like, you're going to have to write a lot in some fashion if you want to be a writer, right? If you want to be good at baseball analysis, you're going to have to publish a lot of analysis and then have the internet tell you you're an idiot and why you're wrong. And that's the form of, that's peer review today. Like, it's just be like, hey, I did this trade analysis on why, like, they should trade Matt Mertens from the Cubs or whatever. This is stupid for this reason, this reason, this reason. The internet's really good at telling you why you're stupid.
Yeah.
You know, and then, like, that's feedback that's super valuable. Like, yeah, it sucks to hear, but it's good. And, like, that's the biggest problem currently is that people think that, like, oh, I went to school, I graduated, employers should, like, do a good job of training people. I spend, at our company, you're allowed to spend basically an unlimited amount of money training yourself. You can fly to any conference you want. You can pay for it all on my dime. I pay for all of it, right? So I do train my employees. But I have 200 applicants for every open position. If you think I'm going to take an unskilled worker over someone who actually knows their shit, like, get out of here. Like, it just doesn't make any rational sense for me. You know, like, that's not going to happen. I'm going to take someone who's got a degree in biomechanics, maybe. Not that I care about education, but I care about what they've done. Like, hey, here's a GitHub of me. Here's all my failed projects. Here's all the projects I fucked up. Here's all the times I tried to get started. Here's some analysis on pitching mechanics that I've written. You know, like, here's a ton of independent work that I've done and toiled trying to get something going. Like, that's the guy I want to hire. That's the guy that I want in, you know? And, that's the person I'm looking for. It's the person I think you're looking for that has a ton of that has a great standout email to you. You know, and that's the frustrating thing. I think that's why a lot of people struggle with the same question that are asked of you and I. That's the number one question we both have in our queue, which is, how do you get started? It's like, how do you not get started? Like, well, that's the easiest part. The easiest part is just, like, doing, you know? And the hardest part is doing it all the time, you know, when you have no conscious feedback. That's the problem, is humanity has this problem, in Americans especially, which is just like, I did something, I deserve something, you know? And not deserve, I'm not trying to say people have that feeling, but, like, if I do X, I should get a stimulus response. If I do this, like, this is what's going to happen. It's like, no, entrepreneurship is 3 years of working with having no clue if it's going to work or not. It's not like, oh, your idea is shit, Cedric, and you're an idiot streaming. What it is you signing on to Twitch, broadcasting for 6 hours, and no one talks in chat. That's the despair that an entrepreneur feels in the early stages. Does anyone care? Like, because if they hate it, at least someone says something.
Yeah.
But when you stream for 4 hours and no one says a damn thing, that's tough, you know? And that's what it is. Like, when I write for baseball and I write on the Hardball Times, it gets 100 views a month at the most. You know, like, is anyone reading this? Who the hell's reading this? Who are the 100 people that read this? Turns out that it's general managers sometimes. Just takes one time, right? It just takes one time to be lucky. And that's, you just need to buy as many lottery tickets as possible. And that's what that is. And, unfortunately, people just want to be like, well, I'm not going to buy a lottery ticket unless it's going to win. Oh,
yeah.
How is that going to scale exactly?
Yeah.
Like, so everyone who buys a lottery ticket gets to win? Oh, well, no, obviously not. Just me. Interesting.
Yeah. Like, that's the thing that's really... And this is the thing that I'm trying to, like... I feel like this is a source of stress in my life, and I'm obviously trying to eliminate that with what I'm trying... with everything I'm trying to do. But it's like, you know, I go through these, like, moments of rage, right? Where it's like, I get that kind of email, and, like, immediately my thought is just, like, okay, like, so does this... Is this person stupid? Am I stupid? Like... Should I be mad about this? Should I not be mad about this? Because, like, part of me is just like, well, you know, they don't really know any better, and they're just trying to do the best they can. But at the same time, it's just like, why the fuck don't you know any better?
Sure.
You know? And so, like, I'm always trying to rationalize with myself. It's just like, well, you know, example, right? Where we post, let's say, like, SCG posts an announcement of, like, a bunch of stuff they're going to change, right? For, like, the SD tour.
Sure.
And, like, someone who writes for us posts on there, and he's just like, this is bullshit. And it's just like, you could literally contact me, your boss, and we could talk about it, and we can have a productive conversation, but you felt the need to do it that way. And say, like, hey, this is dumb that we're making all these changes, which looks bad for you, looks bad for us, looks bad for, like, a lot of different things, when you could have just said it to me, and then, like, we could have a conversation, I can explain to you why we're doing what we're doing, because that's part of you working here. Like, but at the same time, it's just like, well, should I be mad that they're expressing their public opinion on a public forum,
sure,
even though they work for us, or should I be mad about that, or should I not be mad about that? And it's like these, it feels like it's a bunch of, like, these weird cases where it's just like, I do not enjoy getting upset. It's not what I strive to do. But at the same time, when someone does something that doesn't make sense to me and I try to rationalize it, I'm just like, I don't understand why people behave the way that they do, but I want to understand. But with how I'm wired, it's so hard for me to rationalize it and have empathy and understand it and move on from it. And I don't know if that's something that you deal with.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
With the fucking deals that you have to deal with baseball what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah, these people are so stupid.
Yeah. But then you're also just like, well, maybe they're not stupid. Maybe they just, like, saw things this way and that's okay. So I shouldn't be upset about this or be frustrated about this. It's just kind of the way things are. But it's like, well, why the fuck are things that way?
Right.
But it's just like, this is just the way of the world and the way of people, maybe?
Yeah, in my case, it's just like, I'm barking up the wrong tree. Like, these people are in the positions of power that they're in, not because they're good at that type of forecasting. Like, the people that are good at it are the owners, the billionaire owners of the teams. Like, they would understand if I were to pitch it to them. They'd be like, oh, yeah, of course, that makes total business sense. You know, but like, general managers, AGMs, people below them, they lack the proper stimulus. They lack the proper reward. It's just like, oh, you know, like, interesting. Like, the Houston Astros have, like, really redefined baseball. That's how I feel about it. You know, how they've completely done it. And, like, I just look around and, you know what, like, multiple front offices believe? Like, the Astros are good because they tanked and they cheat. It's like, okay, they tanked and they cheat. Yeah, they do. Absolutely, they cheat. You know, like, they get caught for it, you know? They're being investigated. But, like, that's exactly what the general manager of the Astros wants you to think. Oh, yes, we win because we tanked for 4 years and we cheat. And that is the reason we are good. Yes, please continue thinking that. Like, please do not investigate any of the player development initiatives that we do. Please do not investigate how differently we scout players. Like, please, let's not do that. Because if you don't look into that and you're just talking about how we cheat, that's perfect. Like, that's exactly what they want.
You know, one of my favorite things in life is I like that there's like a subset of people who just think I'm a moron.
Oh, yeah.
That likewise. Is fun to me.
Yeah, likewise.
Yeah, like just being loud and boisterous and all this other stuff. It's like, in a weird way, because I don't give a fuck what people think about me. I never have. I never will. But it's just like, I like that people think that I'm stupid or may think that I'm dumb, just like the Astros. Because it's just like, well, good. That gives me opportunity to take advantage of something.
Yeah, that's the problem, unfortunately, that is the duality of entrepreneurship and opportunity, is that true opportunity never looks like a good idea. Like, it just, by default, it doesn't. Like, if streaming looked like a good idea today, which it looks like a good idea today, it probably isn't for most people. When you started streaming, it looked like a terrible idea, and it could have been, you know, but like, that's what an opportunity looks like. It's like, by definition, nobody must think it's a good idea, right? So, like, how is it possible that everyone would think that this is a good idea? Now, like, you know what might be a good idea? Investing in Bitcoin right now. Probably not. But you know what? Fucking no one else thinks it's a good idea outside of crazy people, you know? Like, there's just a lot of stuff that if you somehow could foretell the future and you knew 12 months from now that Bitcoin was going to go to 25,000, it's at, like, 4,000, I think, right now. Even if you knew that, like, say you have divine knowledge of that, it would be impossible to convince people. Like, of that. And then that's actually, like, what opportunity. Say somehow you knew you were going to be a successful streamer. I think you always thought that there was an opportunity. That I always thought that baseball could be, that I could always create this company. I always thought that it could be something. Like, I mean, it doesn't matter even if you knew. Like, it would actually be worse if you knew the truth. Because then it would be really hard. You would go insane thinking about it. Which is basically where I'm at with the Astros. Because I know the truth. I know how the Astros, I work there. I know what they're doing. I know how they do it. Like, at least 80% of it. I stood up in front of 500 coaches over a couple weeks ago, and I said, you guys, all of you out here, there were 18 MLB teams in attendance, all these college coaches, and just like, you guys are idiots. You guys are just absolutely missing the boat. How can you do this? You know, it would be like if you worked at Star City Games and then another card sales company who didn't have like a ton of money backing them. Just like start outselling you in every card, like price their cards perfectly, just like kick the shit out of Ben on bidding on cards. Like they knew how to bid card, like they were superior to you guys in every possible way. And you would just be like, well, this must be lucky. Like that, sure. That would be like, that's what's happening in baseball right now. And that would be like, you wouldn't do that. You would go to Pete and you'd be like, why? What is that? We got to figure it out. You know, like, what are they doing? Who do they hire? Why do they do it? You do a root cause analysis. How did they get so successful when we weren't even paying attention? Like, was it our fault? Like what you would start thinking that way because that's how a good business owner thinks. But like in baseball, they're just like, you know, the Astros went from the worst team in the big leagues, worst farm system to the best farm system and the best big league team in the space of 7 years. And it must be luck. What? Like, why the fuck would you ever think that about anything else? But in baseball, that's what they think. Like, oh, they lost. They tanked. That's why they're good. 76ers. They're good because they tanked. Is that the truth? Like, it helps. Obviously that they tanked, but how about roster construction when they tanked, forecasting the draft, like figuring that stuff out, like Sam Hinkie's genius deserves some credit. You know, it's not just all tanking. Yes, it's part of it. 100%. I'm not saying it's not.
Yeah.
Right. But like there was a process, there was a vision, and it was immensely unpopular. Right?
See, that's why I'm such a Hinkie fan
is because, of course, same.
Is because, and this is just, I've been operating this way forever in my life. And it's weird because I feel like more people should operate this way more. But also, I'm also just like, maybe it's dangerous. I don't know. But it's like when you have Hinkie believes in what he was doing. right? No matter what the public said,
nope.
No matter what anyone said, he's like, I'm going to operate this way. We are going to lose. I'm going to put a team on the court that's going to lose, and we are going to try to break it through these various means, right? That is the plan, and we are going to do the plan and fuck with public thinks. The fans, sorry, we're going to be bad for a while. That sucks for you guys. Buy tickets. Don't buy tickets. Don't really care.
Right.
You know, I'm going to see this through, and it's going to go however it's going to go, and maybe I'll get fired for it. Maybe I'm wrong. Who knows? But, like, I'm going to do it, right? So that was how I was with the streaming. I was like, I'm going to do this, and maybe I'm right, maybe I'm wrong, but, like, I don't have anything to lose, so let's do that. Or, you know what? I think that we need to change the way we're doing content in a couple different ways, and I could be wrong about this. I could be right about this. The beginning of this year, changed the model from, like, four different options to $7.99.
Right.
Every month on Star City. That was my idea.
Yep.
I got
direct all hate to add Cedric A. Phillips.
That's me. If you were mad at the price of the premium subscription, you can yell at me. You have one option. Sorry, not sorry. And you know what? When we announced that, it was not a good day.
No, you told me.
It was not a good day for me. A lot of people were mad. A lot of people canceled their subscriptions, so on and so forth.
Pete was mad. Everyone was mad. It was great.
We were mad. People were not happy. And you know what? I have a great boss in Pete Hoffling who believes in my idea and my vision and let me see it through. And now we're having a record November, December, and I'm super happy about it. And I have an amazing team of content producers that I wouldn't be able to do this without. But, you know, like, it would be very easy for me to bring that to someone and just be like, hey, I think this is going to work. And then being like, you're fucking out of your mind. But it's like, well, I'm just pretty sure. And so I'm going to see this through and see where it goes. And, like, you're absolutely right. I could be wrong. But, like, there's just no fear of failure. There's no fear of being wrong. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have a problem with that. And I think that that's weirdly like a thing that I think when you care about, I think you have a fear of failure when you care about what other people think. But if you don't care what other people think, then it's just like, yeah, maybe I just totally muffed this. Maybe I do this and it's just like, yeah, we shit the bed on this one. This is horrible news. I mean, shit the bed really badly on the No Banless Modern Open at SCGCon Summer. Like, I thought it'd be wildly popular. I thought it might sell out, all this other stuff. People told me it wouldn't. I was like, we should do it anyway. And, you know, a lot of people have confidence in my thoughts and my feel on what Magic players want. We had like 250 people or something like that. I think the people who played it had fun, but, you know, the barrier to entry was higher than I thought for that tournament with regards to building a deck and interest and unfamiliarity. And so that tournament was bad.
Sure.
It was just bad. It was just,
only winners, so
yeah, yeah, it was just not good. And so it's like, no one takes it on the chest but me. You know, like, I convinced Pete and everybody else to do it. And then, like, it's just like, well, it actually had less people than like a 4-round modern tournament taking place at the same time.
Sure. Oof.
That weekend. Tough. And like the open is like $100,000 prize pool. That other one was like prize wall tickets. So it's just like, you know, kind of whatever.
Right.
And it's just like, you see the attendance for this and this. And I'm just like,
I did Pete.
Sorry. I do. And it wasn't Pete bringing this up, but it was just like,
oh, you should have.
I do. Yeah. It's like, I do. And, yeah. And they're just like, so we're not gonna do that again. I'm like, that. Yep. That's fair. Sorry. I was wrong. Yeah. But you know, that's part of doing it.
That was the number one thing I learned from the Astros. Not about cheating or any of that stuff. Like, what I learned from Jeff Lunau, who's the GM. Do they have smart people there? Absolutely. They have really smart people. But a movie that I like, Margin Call.
Clooney?
No. It's a bunch of kind of no ones. And then Spock is in it from Star Trek. One of the later Star Treks or whatever that guy's name is. The lead actor, oh God, who's super famous, and it's just killing me. The guy that runs the hedge funds, like, you could either be smart or you can be first. And being first is a lot easier than being smart, you know? And Jeff, I took that to mean a lot of things, but Jeff Lunau is smart and has a lot of smart people around him. But what he has is strong conviction in his actions, which means he makes, when he's wrong, man, he makes some bad calls. Like, we're going to draft Mark Appel first overall. Wow, that was bad. We're going to draft Brady Aiken, Jacob Nix, and Mac Marshall and package them together. And then it backfires massively because Aiken wouldn't sign. And, like, it just torpedoed their draft. And then, you know what? The next year with the comp pick they got for Brady Aiken, they drafted Alex Bregman. You may have heard of him.
He's a fairly good baseball player who knocked out the Indians by himself.
That's right. Very good friends with Trevor Bauer.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the thing is, like, he has strong convictions. But, like, you can point out all the L's that Jeff has. But also, like, Jeff also packaged Carlos Correa and Lance McCullers in the same draft. You know, like, all of these things that happened. And you have strong conviction to make decisions. And I see in baseball a bunch of people who sit on the fence and don't have any conviction on player development or scouting or try to actually get anything done. And it's really easy to throw rocks at someone who stands for something and is wrong. But that is what it is. You know, like, that you're going to be wrong. You can't always be right. You know, but, like, your conviction, you have to do the research, and then it's a process. And his right-hand man, who's now with the Orioles, that helped him rebuild it, Sig Madahl, who's the smartest person I've ever met. Sig kind of was quoted in Sports Illustrated and said, you know, I'm confident that we're making the right process. We have a great process and we're making good decisions. But I love my job in baseball and I will be immensely disappointed and sad if it doesn't turn out, the results don't turn out, you know. But like, I am confident that we have a good process and the rest is hope. You know, it's just a great quote from like 2013, you know, that was prescient in them winning the World Series or whatever. But it could have not worked. The Astros could be like completely bad today, you know, but at least, and Sig said this to me in person, and he's not going to listen to this, so it's fine. But Sig told me, he's like, all I want to do is to succeed or fail on my own merits. Like, I had the chance, I took a shot, and I made it or I missed it, you know. And that's, I think, if you want that in your life, then entrepreneurship is for you, for sure. Like, but there's a lot of, but you have to really ask yourself if you really want that. People want that. People say they want that. At Driveline, we employ a lot of people. There's very minimal management. Very, like, the way that we instill management layers comes from, it's anarchy. Like, here's complete anarchy. Did that work? No. Okay. We'd have to have a minimum of management. Okay. But did that solve the problem with project management? Yes. Okay. No more management. No new managers, no new processes, none of that bullshit. People get to make their own decisions, spend the company's money however they want. That's still true. You can spend the company's money however the hell you want as long as you log it and no one reviews it really. You know, like, that's all fine.
Okay.
But the minute someone buys like a 55-inch flat screen TV and then flies to Dubai to party, F that. Now we have management over
insurance. Now we have an issue.
Hey. Yep. No, nope. You know, like that, like, we trust our employees. When someone asked me, is like, what if someone takes the corporate company credit card who we issued all of our full-time employees? Like, what if he just buys a TV? And what if he buys a bunch of stuff? He's fired and probably going to go to jail, actually. I'm going to call the cops. Like, there are actual legal avenues to this. What do you want to – you want to act like you don't trust your employees? Is that what you want to do? Oh, you're probably going to get a lot out of them. You know, like, I just – so we operate on pure anarchy as best we can, and then we instill management layers as we need it, right? But the problem is people hear that. And they go, man, it would be great to work for Kyle. I make all my own decisions. It's like, guess what? I have 30 extremely talented people who work at Driveline. And you compete not only with like the external baseball, but within. Who do you think I promote? I promote the best employees inside. So they all compete with each other for the promotions, for what exists, you know. And some guy quit, who's a great employee. We'll take him back if he wants to come back. But he just said, like, look, it feels like by the time I come up with an idea on what I want to do, someone's already doing it. You know, it's like, yeah, man, like, people are incentivized to work their ass off and to do things and be first because they get promoted, they get put into increasing responsibility roles, and they get paid a hell of a lot more if they actually are more productive here. That's what we do. Like, I incentivize my employees to be entrepreneurs inside the company. Some people just want to punch the clock and make 40 grand a year and just show up for 40 hours and live a normal life. I need that guy. I need him. I don't think less of him. In fact, I think more of him in a lot of ways. You know, he's determined what's important to him. He needs to make enough money for himself. He's young. And he's like, yeah, I go out at night. I have a girlfriend. I have other hobbies. I got a part-time job on the weekends that I like, you know. And baseball is just not my passion. That's fine. I'm not asking for it to be necessarily. Like, you know, but for the people that it is, it's my obligation to provide upward mobility to them, in my opinion. To, like, give them the opportunity to succeed, the opportunity to make more money, and to align their interests. Otherwise, they're going to quit, you know. So, like, that's not for everyone. There's a lot of people who can't handle that. And that's, if you can't handle the pressure that comes with that, then an entrepreneur is not for you, you know. And my company is at least nice because, like, you're going to get a weekly paycheck, you know.
Sure.
Otherwise, you're not. But your upside is limited. You're never going to own 100% of Driveline Baseball. You're never going to own more than 20%. You're never going to own an appreciable part of Driveline Baseball. But, like, you know, if that's what you want, if you want to own 100% of, like, a $1 million company and you want to say that you did it, shit, that's hard. You know, going from zero to one, people should all read that book by Peter Thiel. There's a disease. He talks about it. And I'm not going to put words in his mouth. But from the book, I actually think that there's a huge disease of incrementalism. That's what's taught in schools. Like, do this and then chip away at society and get something a little bit better and prove you're a better pizza maker or, like, whatever your job. If you get a little bit better, that contributes to the world. And Peter makes the argument that that's bad. And I think it's awful. Like, I think it's just terrible. Like, the idea that incrementalism is how we're going to actually advance as a society is bullshit. Like, the title of the book is Zero to One for a reason. Like, going from one to a million is way easier than going from zero to one. Convincing someone that they want something that they've never had before is nearly impossible, right? But it is what all entrepreneurship is based on, right, is figuring out where life is going to go and beating that to the spot, right? And that means being wrong actually quite a bit of the time, you know, and the faith that it takes to get into it. So I think take a quick break, and then we can talk a little bit more about the machinations of it. I think we can take some questions, and like the process behind it, I think would be good for listeners to talk about exactly what went through our minds, the process of it, rather than just being like, you know, we're psychopaths, which is true. But I think it would make more sense to like break down a little bit. So
yeah, sure. All right.
Part one in the books between Kyle Bodie and myself, chit-chatting about 2018 and where our lives have been and where they are going. The Q&A part will be coming up here in part number two, so hopefully you do enjoy that. But I do want to thank each and every single one of you for listening to the podcast, which, of course, you can find on Stitcher, SoundCloud, iTunes, the podcast app, and Patreon, where you can become a patron at patreon.com/thecedricphillipspodcast. Also, if you like what you heard, feel free to click that subscribe button and give me a rating, preferably 5 stars, over on iTunes. More stuff with Kyle to come, as I mentioned, with the Q&A, but we'll also be doing this a little bit more regularly in 2019, as I have certainly built podcasting into my schedule for 2019. Very excited to do so, as you can already tell, putting out a lot of content so far throughout the new year, and plenty of great things to come. So, again, hope you enjoyed it, and part two will be coming soon. Thanks, guys. Don't you know-